Hey, everybody. Welcome to a special Metawatch for Age of Sigmar. My name's Paul, joined by Matt.
Hey, how's it going?
Welcome.
Yeah.
We are right off the tail of the Las Vegas Open 2024, largest Age of Sigmar tournament of all time, I believe.
Yeah, that's right. Almost 350 players here. It was an amazing event. We've all been here throughout and just finished minutes ago with a very, very exciting final, which I'm sure we're going to talk about in a minute.
We will definitely talk about it. I want to talk about the lead up to that.
All
the players, large event here in Vegas, all the enthusiasm in the room, great. Like, you could feel it.
There's a huge vibe.
Yeah, big energy, exactly. Yeah. But they cut down to like first top 16 and then top 8.
Yep.
Let's talk about the top 8 a little bit.
What
did you see? Any surprises?
The lead up was basically we had all these players that played a 5-game event through, and you know, then that sorted down into the top 8. We had a really great variety in the top 8, 7 different factions represented in the top 8, with only Cities of Sigmar in there twice, 2 cities lists making in very, very different lists, which was cool to see. And then we had Stormcast Eternals, great to see in the top 8, and Cruel Boys. Ogre Maw Tribes, Soulblight Gravelords, Khorne, and Caradhran Overlords.
A variety of different things, just like you were talking about.
Yeah,
and
absolutely.
Also, a lot of folks were kind of predicting this might be the breakout, the launching port for the City of Sigmar. So we'll talk about that in just a minute or two, yeah, for sure.
Yeah,
But then, you know, we talked about some of those other factions there. You know, the meta is kind of an evolving thing. How do you look at it? What do you think about?
Yeah, I mean, it's the balance of the game is in a pretty healthy spot right now. As you mentioned, we've really had our eyes on Cities of Sigmar because this is one of the first really major events since the book has been legal for matched play, right? Since the Battle Tome's been out, and so this is one that we had our eyes on, and we saw a huge variety of completely different cities lists. You know, we had lists focusing on Darkling Coverns, lists focusing on different builds with different unit types, and so that was really cool. In terms of the other factions, it's pretty wild these days because the balance of the game's in pretty good shape. So you had a lot of factions in the middle of the pack. It was anyone's guess as to which factions were going to make it to the top 8. So we've had factions that have been struggling in terms of win rate for a little while, like Cruel Boys or Stormcast Eternals make it into the top 8. We saw a big representation of Cruel Boys, Iron Jaws, and Big Wah all about even in the pack in terms of number of players playing them. It was a great breakdown of factions, great breakdown of results. Really, really cool to see.
And then also some well-known players that they've been mainstays on the tournament scene, and how they approach the meta. Like some of these lists we're talking about, like the Soulblight Gravelords,
and things like
Caradhran Overlords, and those types of things making an appearance. How did you think they were matching up there, playing out in the top 8?
Yeah, I mean the games were all really interesting. So I watched all of the top 8 games and quite closely talked to a lot of the players. I think. Every build really had a plan in mind, right? Every build was built around a strategy, and the players knew what they had to accomplish. They knew what they had to try to stop their opponent from accomplishing. And so really interesting seeing how those kind of lists played into each other. There were some really exciting games, some really close matchups, all culminating in the big finale.
And speaking of the big finale, there was a couple of lists in the finale. What did you think about that reveal? What actually made the finals?
Yeah, so the finals ended up actually being the 2 Cities of Sigmar lists that made it into the top 8, which was cool to see. Now, these 2 lists were both very, very different. So Gavin Grigar, who is well-known and well-performing players, done a lot of big results at a lot of big events, was playing a very steam tank heavy list supported by Alchemite Warforger, Sorceress, and the Command Core.
It had layers to it. It was actually really cool to see how it all played together.
Yeah, so it's a great list, but it's really focusing around these steam tanks that it could kind of buff up. The Herc Hanuman as well could kind of buff up these steam tanks and really control the board, but often struggling to have enough models on objectives because the steam tanks only count as 2, and so doesn't have a lot of objective control, but against a lot of lists, the firepower was so high that it could kind of just blast the opponent off the table going in. The other list, which was really cool to see from Jeremy, was a really, really mixed mixed cities list.
Had lots of tools in it.
Lots of tools, lots of tech, you know, lots of tricks on all of these different units that I think is a really, you know, from the looks of it, very difficult list to pilot in terms of lots of abilities to keep track, lots of buffs that need to go on the right thing, abilities to use at the right time, positioning is really tricky. So that was a Alchemite Warforgers, similar. He used Hexbane, Haskell Hexbane, as well as Hexbane's Hunters, the Warband, Pontifex Zenestra, Freegailed Cavalier Marshal, and Marshal on Griffin, and Galen and Duralia Vendenst, some Steel Helms, two units of Cavaliers, Wilder Corps Hunters, and two Command Corps. Providing, you know, those buffs. So, you know, really lots of tools, lots of different little units doing different things. And so, you know, really very, very different lists going into each other at the end there.
You know, with the first big outing, like we're talking about that, did you have your eye on anything particular with that list? Like we saw, like, the Command Corps getting the workout this weekend.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I mean, as I said, we've really had our eyes on cities and looking towards this. Obviously, we've got a battle scroll coming up, which we'll talk about in a bit. And so, you know, always curious to see how these different units are landing, how they're being used. I think the double command corps was very popular here at LVO. It's in a lot of lists. You know, it's a decent points commitment, but both having the having two chances for stopping opponents' commands. The Whisper Blade is really, really useful. The Surgeon. And, you know, it's actually a pretty decent unit in combat as well. So it's got lots of tools, you know, people committing it in and getting into the fight. Obviously, you've got a good amount of wounds on the unit. So, you know, very popular choice. You know, probably as a unit, a bit doing a bit better than we'd like, a bit too efficient in that, you know, we never want a unit to really be an auto-include, especially multiples of a unit. So definitely something we're looking at moving forward.
And guys, speaking of moving forward, you know, there was also, they said we talked about the top eight and the different types of lists in there. These generals had to battle through a lot of tough lists. You know, it really could have been differences there just with slim margins any games, how it went. It was exciting to watch. Were there any, like, standout moments for you from the games that you got to witness?
Yeah, there were some really fun moments. One moment in particular was in one of the games with Khorne against Stormcast Eternals. It was right down to the end. It looked like Stormcast Eternals had it clinched, but the score was so close that all Khorne needed to do at the end was to get a tactic, and in order to get that tactic, they needed to summon another unit. But they just didn't have enough Blood Tithe to summon a unit. And so on the last turn, there was only two Khorne units left on the table. There was Thedra, Skullscryer, and one Reaver. And so Thedra intentionally cast a spell and dumped all of the primals in order to try to get a primal miscast, which she did successfully, blowing herself up, generating a Blood Tithe. And then in the battle plan, if you ran, you could have a risk of taking damage. So the Reaver ran, took damage, killed himself, generating another Blood Tithe, getting just enough to summon the unit, put them on the table, cinching the victory.
That's pretty cool.
At the last moment. So
risk
that was a really fun
versus
moment.
Reward there. Yeah. Pretty awesome.
Desperate play.
And jumping back to the finals game here, talking about close scores, it actually came down to the event's tiebreakers. So
yeah, that's right.
But these are two radically different lists. I mean, two different generals and the way they approach the game. So again, fun to watch if, you know, people can find that coverage.
It was a great game, and it was you know, very, very close throughout, with, you know, back and forths, the steam tanks finally starting to fall. Which is something that hasn't happened in almost any of the other games. They're incredibly tough to kill with a 2-up armor save, doing really, really well. Several of them fell. You know, there was some key tactics that were denied or blocked. And so, you know, incredible game, and it came down to an 18-18 tie. Had to go down to the second tiebreaker for the event. They had the same number of tactics scored, and ultimately it was just down to the Grand Strat. The fact that Jeremy won the Grand Strat, or succeeded to the Grand Strat, that was the second tiebreaker. For the game.
Well, let's talk about, if we can, a little bit of the data. So we're talking about things we've witnessed, we've seen, but this is just one event happening. There are events happening, games being played all over the world.
Yeah.
How do you look at data like this and start to incorporate it into maybe what you're thinking about next?
Yeah, for sure. So, I mean, we're always gathering data from events all around the world. You know, that's definitely something that we take very seriously. So, you know, what we tend to do is we tend to intentionally gather as much data as we can in order to lower the margin of error with the data that we get. So we collect data for thousands and thousands of games around the world. We put it in, but then, you know, that gives us a very big mix of data. You have data from 3-game events, 5-game events, small events, big events. So then within that, we filter down and look at only certain types of data. So sometimes we'll look at only GTs or only 5-game events or only 3-game events and just try to use that to check if there's any different patterns that show up, knowing, of course, that the more you filter down, the more you increase the margin of error, right? So we kind of slice the data up and look, and then we also look at data from parsed lists from those events. And what that gives us is that gives us things like sub-faction, per sub-faction win rates and inclusion, per war scroll win rates and inclusion, so we can kind of see which units in particular are overperforming or underperforming, over-included. And so that gives us a whole wealth of data, a whole wealth of tools. And then we share that out with our Metawatch advisor group, make sure that we get that human angle from, you know, TOs of major events, including LVO and many of the biggest events in the world. And, you know, really make sure that what we're seeing in the data lines up with their experience at these huge events. And that ultimately leads to us drafting out potential balance changes for a battle scroll, which we then kind of workshop with that group and iterate on, really trying to hit the right note. And of course, that will ultimately culminate in a battle scroll.
And I know there's a lot of anticipation right now about maybe, you know, will they, won't they, what's happening next kind of thing. Is there anything you can share with us to while we have you here as to maybe what folks can maybe start to anticipate?
Yeah, so the next battle scroll will be coming up soon. Now, I know people are very eager for it, and it will be, you know, still a little bit of time to wait, not too long. But, you know, we wanted to make sure to be able to benefit from our experience here at LVO, to be able to talk to players, get a sense of the game, and also, you know, to align with some upcoming releases. Not too long to wait. It is coming. It is coming soon. But, you know, just hang tight.
Well, that's awesome. Well, we had a fabulous time here hanging out with you, all the players, all the organizers. They've hosted us here. They've very nice and they're really happy to be here. It's been great talking to you. Is there anything else you want to share before we wrap this up?
Oh, it was an amazing event. Honestly, a blast to be here. I love coming and meeting players, talking to players, and just seeing games at this caliber being played. Really, really incredible for Age of Sigmar. You know, it's a new milestone for us to hit with this event. So really exciting times.
Awesome. Well, y'all heard it. You heard what he's got to say. Hold tight. Got some cool stuff coming. We'll see y'all next time, everybody.